It was pretty clear for everyone watching our show in the last year or so that the 2024 moon landing goal was not too realistic. And now with the new NASA fiscal year 2021 Senate spending bill, it looks as if this date cannot be kept up anymore. But when can we expect humans on the moon again? And then with which lander? And we cannot blame Jim Bridenstine for having enough of this show, and that he's not too keen anymore on remaining NASA administrator, as it seems.
But not enough. The Lunar Gateway is now also delayed. At least, the Crew-1 mission seems to be right on track for a launch on Sunday, the 15th of November. And Falcon 9 with Crew Dragon is now officially NASA human-rated. Let's also take a look at Starship's progress at Boca Chica. Before we go to some updates on Mars, turns out, besides underground caves and lava tubes, subglacial lakes might be another hiding place for life on the red planet. A lot to talk about again, so stay tuned.
Okay, so the fiscal year 2021 spending bill for NASA is materializing. An appropriations bill was introduced on November 10th in the Senate, which foresees a total of $23.495 billion of funding for NASA for the year 2021. This is $866 million more than the House bill, but $1.75 billion below NASA's request for fiscal year 2021. And where are those $1.75 billion missing? That's right, mostly from the human landing systems. So now that it looks more and more as if Biden's win is pretty secured, the scenario that we've been warning about since over a year now is materializing. Say about Trump what you will, but contrary to the mainstream media's attitude that everything he did was bad because of course orange man always bad, in fact the Trump administration was really the best administration for space exploration in a very, very long time. Not only was the Space Force created as a necessary reaction to China's aggressive expansion in space, but under this administration, the ambitious goal to return humans to the moon by 2024 was set in motion. I mean, this was the most aggressive and ambitious space exploration timeline since the days of Apollo. But the signs were already there that if the Dems would take over, the 2024 goal would most certainly slip. Kendra Horn's infamous HR 5666 bill gave us a good preview of what would happen. And now it is unfortunately indeed happening.
The human landing systems would only get $1 billion in 2021, instead of the requested $3.2 billion. This means several things. First, a 2024 human landing date is now all but ruled out. We can be happy if it's 2026, but more likely it will be even later, probably 2028. NASA won't have enough money to keep all three contenders for the human landing system in the game, and we'll have to decide for two, or maybe only even one. We remember that SpaceX, pneumatics, and the national team were the three companies, or conglomerates, chosen to build the moon lander for the Artemis program. Pneumatics with their excellent Alpaca lander. SpaceX with their totally overpowered, insanely large moon version of Starship. And the national, or lobby team, with their very tall and complicated three-stage moon lander, which for obvious reasons we like the least. And if NASA really has to decide for only one moon lander, we believe the chances are pretty high that they will decide for the worst system, namely the lobby lander. Why? Because it's boring. Because it's absolutely not revolutionary. This is exactly what the government likes. Also, all those senators can keep their nice jobs at Boeing, Lockheed, Northrop, and so on. Because the lobby team's landing system would employ SLS, Orion, and the lobby lander. Of course, we hope that NASA will go for SpaceX. It would also be by far the cheapest and most efficient solution. For $1 billion, SpaceX would probably have enough funding to build a few lunar starships. Because Starship is fully reusable and doesn't need the SLS and Orion architecture. Long term, the lunar Starship would be much cheaper than the lobby lander, or even the Alpaca lander. We will know in March 2021 how NASA finally decides. But should they really decide to move forward without SpaceX, this might actually be beneficial for human spaceflight. Why? Well, because we are pretty sure that SpaceX will then land astronauts on the moon without NASA. Elon might just decide to completely bypass NASA and land a few starships on the moon as a sort of demonstration mission to test systems for future flights to Mars.
We shouldn't forget that the moon is the ideal exercising ground for later Mars missions, so this certainly makes a lot of sense. So paradoxically, if NASA would decide against SpaceX, we might actually see humans return to the moon faster than if NASA decided for SpaceX. That's certainly kind of counterintuitive, but that's what we think is quite likely to happen. And please consider subscribing to our channel because we are the most aggressive anti-PC space channel out there. Oh, and please turn on the notification bell, otherwise YouTube might not show the latest episode to you. Oh, and we're planning to do another live stream next week, so be sure to check out our YouTube channel homepage for the exact time and vote for the topic you'd like us to cover. Thank you very much! With all this stuff going on, the constant fight for every funding dollar for NASA in the Senate, and with a 2024 moon landing goal all but impossible now, it is pretty clear that Jim Bridenstine has had enough of this. Last episode we were still hoping that he would change his mind, but now reports are surfacing that Jim would have stepped down as administrator even in the case of a second Trump term. This is really sad because he is the best NASA administrator since the administrators in the days of Apollo. When he steps down in January, it will be a sad day for NASA, and we don't think there will be someone of his caliber to take over. NASA might then continue on its path to become more and more unimportant, and SpaceX will probably completely take over the role of human spaceflight to the moon and Mars. Under Jim Bridenstine, NASA could have made a gigantic comeback and usher in a new era of Apollo-like glory. But probably without his leadership, we think it's very likely that NASA will continue to revel in past achievements and past glory and continue its decline towards total insignificance regarding human spaceflight.
Even the Lunar Gateway faces delays and cost overruns, as the last report of NASA's Inspector General from November 10th shows. The first two modules of the Gateway, the Halo and PPE modules, were foreseen to be launched together on a Falcon Heavy in 2023. But now, this date is quite likely to slip to 2024. But since the NASA-led return to the moon will slip to around 2028 anyways, this new timeline at least seems more realistic. SpaceX will not only launch the two modules, but will also contribute a logistics module, probably in the form of the Dragon XL, which we were first shown in renderings earlier this year. So NASA's return to the moon is progressing super slowly. And in this scenario, we would have a small tiny moon base no earlier than 2030, probably comprising of only one or two small habitat modules, which is really pathetic if you ask us. So all our hopes for future human spaceflight are resting on SpaceX. Now that NASA will play less and less of an important role for our future on the moon.
Luckily, SpaceX is building the Starship at Boca Chica, which is the most important vehicle for our future return to the moon and our future settlement of Mars. Even though we ranted about too much focus on Starship, but then again we have to say, nothing else is coming even remotely close to the significance of Starship for the future of human spaceflight. To this end, Starship SN8 underwent a successful round of cryoproof and static fire testing, but then the latest static fire test unfortunately encountered some problems. Elon tweeted, "We lost vehicle pneumatics, reason unknown at present. Liquid oxygen header tank pressure is rising. Hopefully triggers burst disc to relieve pressure, otherwise it's going to pop the cork." Doesn't sound too good, but let's hope that this won't delay the 15-kilometer hop for too long. And now you know why we like to be cautious and conservative on time estimates regarding future Starship flights. and why we don't like doing so many 15 kilometer hop soon or 15 kilometer hop imminent videos. But we have to keep in mind that this rate of progress is still 1,000 times faster than Boeing, Lockheed and the likes could ever hope to achieve. At the same time, more and more Starship prototypes are popping up to SN11 already, and then work on the orbital launch pad for the mighty Super Heavy Booster is continuing, while even the first segments of said Super Heavy Booster have been transported into the high bay for stacking. Then of course we have to talk about the upcoming launch of Crew Dragon and Falcon 9 to the ISS. The Crew-1 mission is set to launch on Sunday, November 15th. Here we can see the crew of this 6-month long mission. And Falcon 9 plus Crew Dragon are now officially NASA human rated. The first time a commercial space system has received that rating. We wish that mission the best of success and hope the astronauts will enjoy their 6-month stay on the ISS.
Besides the moon, the big goal of Starship and SpaceX is of course the human settlement on Mars. The red planet is a perfect target for many reasons. We presented the most compelling ones, for example, in this video here. But one very big reason is the possible presence of life, which makes Mars, scientifically speaking, a very exciting target for astrobiology. Even though some hardcore planetary protection berserks want to hinder landings of Starship on Mars, or others know that if we don't live on other planets or moons, we will certainly go extinct here on Earth. Future Mars settlers will be able to explore the deep caves and lava tubes of Mars, which are probably the perfect retreat for microbial Martian life. A new study of data recorded by the Mars Advanced Radar for subsurface and ionosphere sounding instrument carried by the European Space Agency's Mars Express orbiter comes to the conclusion that there are hypersaline subglacial lakes below the South Polar Cap on Mars. Similarly here on Earth, subglacial lakes were discovered below the thick ice of Antarctica, such as Lake Vostok, where it has been found that many microorganisms live in that seemingly life-hostile environment. The salinity of these subglacial lakes on Mars is much higher, because else they couldn't remain liquid at the very low temperatures at the Martian poles, despite the high pressure. Future Mars settlers could make some nice excursions to the South Polar Caps and drill down into these lakes and extract some samples from the lakes. It is quite likely that they will find single-celled life there. And if not there, then in the vast underground lava tube systems of the planet, which are due to the low gravity a lot larger than the lava tubes here on Earth. Either way, our future on Mars will be fascinating, and it will be enabled by SpaceX's Starship. And we are excited to introduce a brand new space podcast from our fellow European space nerds
called Total Space. They give lots of unique perspectives on the latest spaceflight news and space exploration, and we are very honored to have been invited to their show, where next week on Monday we will talk about technologies which we would need in order to settle on Mars. And we put the link to the podcast into the video description.
So thanks for watching the DIS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future!